Hey guys, and welcome to the Merchants of Ofir set review, card review. We're gonna go over all the cards and look at the best ones, the worst ones. And this expansion was a bit of a surprise, and I like that. Instead of just endlessly teasing people, and people are like, yeah, I'm successfully teased now. Please, can I just play the expansion now? I got a little annoyed with that, but I really like this approach. So yes, CDPR, yeah, I prefer this approach to just releasing expansions. So let's just get started. We're gonna go from A to Z. Just gonna go over all the cards, although I try to hurry a little bit up, and I'm gonna put them into five categories. At five, we're gonna have the must-haves. At four, we're gonna have the core cards. I'm cheating a little bit. At three, we're gonna have the playable cards. Two, we're gonna have the bad cards, and one, we're gonna have the hopeless cards. No chance. Bad cards might be okay in some scenarios, but they're still gonna be not very good. Wait, what? Oh, we shouldn't be opening the syndicate here. Just go with the neutrals first. And yeah, I think this is gonna be an okay system. And we have a bunch of these tactical advantage replacements. They are a little pricey, frankly, and you don't need to have all of them to really tell how strong they are. For example, Basilisk Venom, poison random enemy. Yeah, I mean, poison is okay, but keep in mind that even, like, look at this guy. Like, he has a fee and poison enemy, so he has some stats and poison, a specific enemy. The only advantage of the Basilisk poison that the poison can happen at the same turn, so your opponent plays something and you poison it, and you poison it again. But the problem is with that your opponent sees that you have a Basilisk Venom on the board, and it's also random, so if you wait with it, it's gonna be garbage. If it was directed, I could give it a better point, but like this, I just don't recommend it. Tactical advantage is gonna be just better, so this is just a bad card. Maybe not completely hopeless. But, for example, like, if the opponent was, like, running a not too many minion deck, and, like, you can just clear minions, and then you can, I don't know, just too much effort for, like, round one, it's not worth it, it's a bad card. Purify an allied unit and boost it by 3. Purify is kind of worth 2 points, but it's not as good as, like, having just 2 points, so, I don't know, like, this is like a meta call here. I think it's kind of a bad card again. It's very situational. You can just call the category 2 very situational. Boosting it in your hand by 3. This could be good in Scoia'tael or any kind of boosting strategy. Sometimes they can get double the value of the boost. So this could be a 6. But on top of that, if you can win round 1, or even if you lose round 1, this is like a 6-6 value. So, I mean, this is not a must-have by any means, but I don't know if this is a court card. But this is definitely a playable and okay card in Scoia'tael. So, that's like a 3-4 here. It depends. Faction-specific. And very somewhat situational based on that. Curse Scroll, look at the top 3 cards from your deck and draw one of them. Then put a card from your hand to the bottom of your deck. I mean, do you really want to give it the tactical advantage here just to do this effect? I'm thinking no. I mean, it's not worth that much. It's not worth 5 points. So, I mean, I'm not sure if this is hopeless. Maybe with some strategy in the future. I'm just too hopeful here. But, I mean, this looks like a hopeless card, frankly. So, I'm kind of tempted to give it a 1. But maybe you want to lose. You know, you don't want to lose round 1. So, I think this is a hopeless card. It's a 1-2 at best. Damage enemy muted by 3. I do like this card in a way that it shows that CDPR recognizes that damage is better than boost. Although they did work on that by releasing armor and taunt, so damage could be okay, you know, and you can just combine it with some other damage effects to take out the value generator. This is not completely hopeless. I'm like, it's damage. So, but I don't think it's gonna be as useful as the tactical advantage a lot of the times. So I'm just gonna give it a 3. It's a bit of a meta call, and it's gonna depend on the meta whether this minus 3 is gonna be better than a plus 5. Transform to Lamb Gym. Now this is actually not exactly a must-have, but I would say that this is a core card for Skellige. as much as enchanted armor can be a little bit of a core card for not so much, but for Skellige this is a little bit better because Magic Lamp effectively makes any effects that already require a unit on board, already require a unit on board, viable. So you can start round one and you already have a unit to interact with. So for example, you're playing Skellige and you play Swabble Priest. This effectively makes the Swabble Priest 1 point better. This is effectively a boosted Swabble Priest. And it's a five instead of a five boost. Five boost technically is probably a little better because you can protect a value generator with it, but this enables value generation. So, I mean, that's pretty good too. And if you like, yeah, this is an very good card. Not exactly like top tier. Like five is gonna get some pretty nutty stuff, but it can be a core card in Skellige or other factions that require units. But any kind of limited effects are probably not as important because like if it's just like four turns, then you know you can just set it up a little bit later. So it needs to be like continuous effect. Radia, if your starting deck has no duplicates, spawn your faction stratagem in this row. This is a core card, obviously, in the no duplicate deck. But the only problem with the no duplicate deck that it has Shoop in it, that kind of sucks. Actually, just Shoop is not. I mean, it's like maybe worth playing, but like no, I don't think so. He's so bad right now. Radia is worth it. You get 13. And the faction stratagem you pick actually gets played twice a later round. So this is kind of nice. So Radia is clearly worth it. It's auto including the no duplicate deck, but I think the no duplicate deck needs more than this 4 point Radia here. I'm just, it's a very good card. Matahure, deploy range. If neither player has passed and your opponent's hand is not full, they draw the lowest card and you draw the highest cost card. It's a little bit like, although not so much, from Nilfgaard. They didn't really see too much play in the past. I think it's a 7. Not a 7. It's an 8, I think. Yeah. We got here Isabel of Hag. Look at the top cards of both decks. Keep one and give one to the opponent. But, It's similar to that, but not so much. So this is basically always worth it. This is a 5. This is basically a must-have. Although I will make an argument that it shouldn't be a must-have in every case, because you get a 6 for a 9. That's not great. You kind of want more than that. You want upwards an 11 from a 9. So that's kind of the value you're looking for. That usually you want provision cost plus 2. But let's say you draw a 10 and your opponent draws a 4. Although lower provision cost cards tend to get a little bit more for their buck than higher ones. But still, that's a 6 difference. And I'm just going with a reasonable example here. But it can be a ridiculous example. Like you draw like a 12 plus. And then it's clearly worth it. But that is ridiculous. But that's not even all, because if you're running a value generation deck, then this also means you extend the round. So let's say you generate 5 value a turn and you go up against an opponent that just generates no value. He's just like stamming points. That means that you're gonna have one more turn of generating 5 value. So not only you play this card for like, let's say you got a 10 and your opponent got a 4 provision cost, and let's say like a 12 points, but you also extended the round. So your 5 point value generation gave you 5 more value. So you play this for a 17. It's like, okay, that's not bad. So Matahari, this is a good card. But it does have the condition. If neither player has passed, and your opponent's hand is not full. So it does have that condition. And we can just go to Nilfgaard. Not new expansion. That's something Isabel of Hag doesn't have, and I'm kind of a little surprised that Isabel of Hag is not changed. So with Nilfgaard, you can just play, you can win round one, and you can use Isabel of Hag to gain a card from the top two cards. So Isabel is a ridiculous card, but it's order. It's extremely strong, but Mana Hurry just doesn't get shut down. So I mean, wow. I mean, this is just some next level. I mean, like, the amount of points you get here. I mean, if you just go with conservative calculations, it's gonna be ridiculous. Morale, 5/5, whatever. Poison 2 times. I mean, most units tend to give up like 2 points for poison, and he is just pretty good. Like, having 2 poison at the same time. I mean, morale is pretty damn good. I mean, if you look at the other cards, like, the better example of this, I don't really need to look it up. Like, in Nilfgaard, you have a 4-point poisoner that poisons once. You can expect like 11 value from it, and he gives quite a lot of points. Hell, basically, he pays 3 stats for poisons, but he has 2 poisons. I'm like, double effect. I mean, that's clearly worth it because of that. He's capable of taking out a guy by himself, and that's almost guaranteed to happen unless your opponent purifies or taunts. Like, he is... I don't know if I could say that he's a must-have, but he's basically a must-have in poison. Poison the off-guard, and based on the meta, I mean, he could be a must-have. If your opponents are not playing taunts, if your opponents are not playing purify, this is just the best removal in the game. Although it's a little bit delayed, so if you're trying to shut down any powerful order effects that, you know, that have no body, then he won't be the guy, but he is extremely strong. It's kind of like bordering on must-have to a 4. I mean, like, it's not like, not exactly Mata Hari range, but like, this is basically as a 5 as you can close to get a 5. No. As close you can get to a 5. Suck 1. After 2 of your turns, boost self by 10 at the end of your turn. This is not as bad as it looks. 2 to 8. With a taunt in the game and like boosts in the game that can give it some oomph and maybe some armor, maybe some shield. This is just okay. I mean, I think it's playable. You can get 12 points for 8 if you're willing to take a bit of a chance. So, for example, you can have Imperial Formation boosting the Tiger. You can have Azar Javed providing 2 taunts. Because keep in mind, only for 2 turns. So, 2 turns is like you put it down, and like the next turn it's already gonna be good. So, not like you're gonna babysit it for the entire round. It's just like, you know, can you keep it safe a little bit? I'm like, okay. I mean, it's playable, but I don't know, may not worth it. Dula Kamani and Rune Right. We got these guys here. Spawn a desert treasure, which unfortunately just spawn and play a random legendary unit from any faction. I think it's just very RNG. I mean, I understand this is like a funsy card and it can be high power, but there is no guarantee of that, and you might get something that's completely useless. And you need to combine them. So, if you're just looking at the power level and the consistent power level of this, I mean, do you really want to put this into your deck to win games? I'm thinking not. So, I mean, by that alone, it's a weak card, so I'm just going to give it a 2. But they are fun cards, so if you just want some funsy RNG, then they are good choices. Caravan Guard boosts up by 2, spawn a base copy of self in this row. And if bonded, use both abilities. I mean, this is a 6/6 that just gives you bodies on the board. I suppose that's the main advantage of it, that you just want bodies. By themselves, they are really not worth using. And even if you combine them, they only get... the other guy gets a 9, and the first one is a 6. And considering that most... You're kind of looking for an 8 value from a 6, this is just... meh. I mean, this either a 2 or 1. I mean, if you're really desperate for bodies, do you really want the Caravan Guard? Wait. The old Caravan Vanguard. We got the Caravan Guard here. Damage generated by 1, increase the damage by 1 for each free power it has. I mean, basically it becomes break even when it hits 9 power enemies. But if you're dealing with high... high power enemies, wouldn't you rather want some real counters rather than like, oh, if I'm playing against guys who don't have big guys, I guess I lose, or like I might lose because I don't have too many points. But if I play against guys who have big points, I lose anyway because this is not a counter. So maybe it's not completely hopeless, but it's bordering on 2-on-1 range. Swap the top card of your opponent deck with yours. I mean, this is extremely situational. Kind of depends on the deck. Definitely extremely situational craft, so it's like the 2-to-1 range. It's maybe not completely hopeless. It kind of depends on, like, you know, you can set the top cards, and sometimes the opponent set their top cards. So, I mean, and then you have to play the Ofir Merchant to try to get some value. But that means your opponent has to have a good top card, and you have to have a trash one. That's the only situation where the Ofir Merchant is good. And keep in mind that your opponent might actually draw their top card, that's good. So, how do you make this okay? Maybe like put a trash on top of your own deck with Nilfgaard. Let's say you put... Vikovar and Novice. So you put a trash on top of your deck, and you can, If you use Yennefer Invocation, then you put a good card on top of your deck. So like it's a lot of trouble to try to make this work, and your opponent has to have something good at the top of their deck. So you would need to use an Iron Judgment card that's from Syndicate. Wait, no, not Iron Judgment. Good cards. Oh, okay, Courier. You would need to use Courier to mess up their cards and set up yours. I'm like, really worth it at that point? I'm like, this is the best I can think of. I mean, like, maybe like 2-to-1. I don't know. I don't think so. That's a lot of points wasted just to try to make something happen. King Cobra, it's better. It's basically a worse poisoner than you get in Nilfgaard. I think it's give it a free. I mean, it's okay. Like, poison is damn strong with like all the shields and armor and whatnot. Like, poison is just worth it. Like, many times, like, even these guys just gang up on like a 6, they're gonna be really worth it. And sometimes you can find a lot better than that. So, the main advantage of running a poisons in your deck is that your opponent just can't have big stuff at all, because they're just gonna get completely punished. But let's just keep going. Not Nilfgaard here. Let's just go to monsters. And we have their special tactical advantage replacement. So, trigger a bronze ally, death wish ability. I mean, they're kind of cap at 5, so would you really want this over tactical advantage? I think not. So, I mean, this is maybe like a 2-to-3. So, not great. It's kind of bad. But, like, it can give you competitive value. So, I think it's a free. So, it's an advent. It's a possibility. Actually, no. Because this also triggers any Deathfish synergies. So, but then you're playing it round one, so it's a situational call. If you're running a Deathfish deck, this could be a core card, but definitely not a must-have. So, 3-to-4, I think it's more likely here. But, I mean, 3-to-4. If you're running a Deathfish archetype, which they are kind of trying to push here, because I a little bit forgot about the Desert Banshee here. Because that got boosted when a guy gets consumed. So, with the Desert Banshee, it could be like a 4. But don't lose your mind over this. It's not that great. And you also would need to consume something that's really high, like a Harpy. Haunt scenario progress whenever you play a Deathfish. Spawn a Banshee in this row. Play a Barghest. Play a Night Rat. And I really like the design of this card. But at the same time, I have to give it a 2. And I'm gonna give all of them a 2, because they are all artifacts. They're all artifacts. That means you can just go and put in like this guy in your deck, Bomb Heaver, and your opponent just played 14 point dud. You know, no. it's not a complete dud, because you get the first effects. So you basically pay 14 for a Desert Banshee, but this is like scenario, you lose the game. No. It says scenario, prologue, spawn a Desert Banshee in this row and lose the game. This is what it says. So, as long as removal is so binary, I can't recommend this card. And the problem with this card, like, if it doesn't get removed, then it's always worth it. Like, what is this design? It's like, if you just add together the stuff, like, the Bar Guest, that's kind of get played for 8. I mean, just 5. This is a 5. This is a 4. So, even if it's just add together the value of all these units, it's 14. If you just look at the provision cost. Same thing as the Haunt, but like having, yeah, I mean, that's more worth it than just like playing some 14-point one guy, because low-cost cards tend to be more valuable. So, I mean, this is always worth it, unless if it gets removed, in that case you lose the game, most likely. If it's anywhere close. So, I can't recommend it, not until... This would need to be changed, and the artifact removal would need to change. I think it needs to go away, and I can't even talk about like where is she? I was just talking about artifact removal at this point, but I think there's like another card here. I wanna just show it. Why can't I see it? Aurel, where are you? Isn't she a 10? I think she's a 10. Oh yeah. Vivian Aureole. Destroy an enemy artifact and boost up by its provision cost. If they play against play this against you, you just leave the game. even if your artifact just gets removed, you just leave the game anyway. And this happened to many guys, apparently. But it doesn't really matter, you can just have some regular artifact removal and you still lose the game. It's a bit of a shame. I would like this design to a little bit change. Artifact removal to change a little bit, because that's kind of holding the game back. same thing with weather, that needs to change as well. A bit of a off topic there. So Plague Maiden, that fish spawns 7 rats in this row. So you can have a bunch of beasts. That's interesting, and there are synergies for that. But also, this is a lot of points. So, you can use this as like a finisher. This card alone sets up a finisher archetype in monsters. Now, this doesn't work in a long round. So, what you want is win round 1, push round 2, and win a short round 3. And you can just have like a bunch of guys there. You can just have like massive AoE boosts on them, because you can have a lot of guys. So, Plague Maiden seems pretty damn good. I don't know. I think Haunt might be even justifiable in a shorter round, because your opponent might be tempted to mulligan away their artifact removal, because like, yeah, can you really pop your Haunt in like a 4-5 round, long round? I mean, it's a bit of a call. I don't know. I might be tempted to mulligan away, but your opponent might just keep it. So it just depends on the meta. It's definitely a extremely risky card to run, but if it works out, it's always worth it. So we got the beast here at the end of the turn. I wouldn't say like, okay, yeah, this is a, like a 4. I think can enable the archetype, but it's not like ridiculous. At the end of your turn, if this unit is not the highest unit on the board, battlefield boosted by 2, monsters kind of like a little bit of a value generation. So I think the beast is pretty good. It like becomes a 6 right away if you have something better. Although you can just like slam it on the board right away, because that doesn't work. So the beast is decent. I don't know if it's like ridiculous range. It's like 3 to 4 range. I think it's playable. Of course, you need to have an archetype that just doesn't play low, but you know, you have to consume. So because of that, like if you're like running a big archetype with some this gonna give you some long round value, but if you're not, then peace is probably not gonna be that good. So definitely playable, but it's not a must include. Penitent, Thrive, Deathfish, summon a random 7 cost unit from your deck. I mean, this just seems extremely good. You just get a guy. I mean, this just replaces itself. You can just eat it for free and get a 7 cost. Not all 7 costs work for him. So the main limitation here is that if you use Penitent, then you need to decide to use ones, because it's a summon, that don't have instant effects. But that means you can just play a Puggo. You can get a Puggo. 10 points! 10 points with Puggo, and that's good. So you can have like a Puggo, a Beast, maybe you can have a Manticore, so a lot of options here. Let's just go back. So, it's a very good card. I don't know if it's like ridiculous, but like it's close to ridiculous, but it's not exactly Mata Hari range. So, let's just give him a 4, which is basically like a core card, yeah, that's what I named it. Barghest, that's basically like a better Harpy. Yeah, I double consume. And consume is worth like about like one stat point, so he's like a 7-5 kind of. He's pretty good, like order dominance. Dominance should be very easy to do. So I mean, this is a very strong card. Maybe playable to like core range, but it's not ridiculous. There's a Banshee. The main advantage of the Desert Banshee is that she consumes right away. Then she pops, she becomes stronger as well when you play Deathfish cards. But it's not gonna be ridiculously strong. Probably not gonna play a lot of Deathfish cards. Deathfish cards are still just okay, not ridiculous. So she's definitely a 3 here. Definitely worse than Barghest. We got Noombright here. 6-4. That's not particularly good. I think maybe the biggest advantage of this is that you spawn 2 rats in a random enemy row. So you play Noombrate in long round 3, and you eat it, and a lot of the enemies are just like spamming units, and in a long round, especially with these like new cards around or like whatever, with this you can deny 4 squares from your enemy in a long round. That might just mean that they can't play their cards, which is just dumb. Or at the very least, it can mean that they can't play their cards in a specific row, because you can deny 4 slots on like a range row. Oh, the random enemy row. Okay, never mind that. But it's a bit dodgy, and it depends on the meta. But I'm like, this could be just stupid. This could be like, even currently, people are just spamming so many units that I've ran into fights where people just couldn't play their cards. Of course, you can make the argument like, oh, they just kind of fucked up with the design, which is certainly true. But at the same time, it's like, that's the main consideration. Like, can I fit my cards on the board? 9 rats. Yeah, it's a 5-4 that can get some rats here. I don't know about the new rate. I mean, this is just playable. It's okay, a 3. We got the Night Raid here, which is again just playable. It's a 3. So it's just a playable card. Spawn 2 rats. Spawn 2 rats in this row. So I mean, like, okay, we can just, it's a 5-4, and you can eat it. And like, it becomes even more. You just get a bunch of guys. But you gotta be careful, because this is not a card you can play in a long round. You're gonna even get punished for this, because you play this, then your opponent kills it intentionally, or you eat it, whatever, but you have a lot of slots used up because of these rats. So if you're running these rats, I mean, you probably want a 3 round strategy, so actually playing round 2, else you're probably gonna run into troubles. So Nilfgaard, we got lock and damage an enemy by 3, which is just the clear upgrade of the neutral one that just damages by 3. So this is pretty good. Although, yeah, this is pretty damn good. So I mean, if your opponents ever play anything with an ability, this is good. This is good stuff. I mean, this is a strong replacement for tactical advantage. Not a must-have, but it actually sets up lock synergies. So I think the collar is maybe not a must-have, but it's like a core card. It's not a must-have. Masquerade Ball, again, a very spicy card, and that gives you 2 Fangs of the Empire. very nice card, but unfortunately it's bad. It's a bad card. It's not a hopeless card, but it's a bad card because it gets removed by artifact counters, so artifact removal, so I mean, that's sad. Vincent von Morlham. I saw this guy getting played against me, but I'm not super impressed with him. That's partially why I didn't craft him, although the expansion is not out for a very long time. He just gives up a lot of points to destroy enemy unit with status, but the problem is you need to apply the status, and what status you're gonna apply. If you just destroy someone with a poison, then he's a very expensive poisoner. If you destroy someone with luck, wouldn't you rather just steal him with Watier de Redoux? So, not luck. Then what? It's like, maybe bleeds, but then you're making someone bleed and then you destroy him. I'm like, maybe that works. Maybe. But at the same time, applying the bleed in Nilfgaard is the same as the luck. So, and they may have even put up a taunt. You can destroy taunts. You can destroy taunts with Vincent. So, I mean, that's a big advantage there. So, you can crack some big taunts. So, I mean, if you're running into that. But it's not the best against Scarabs. So, Azar Javed is good against him. If you're running into big taunt, then Vincent von Morlham is good. But generally, the idea is, if you are putting the status on them, then he's not worth it. So you need to be looking out for statuses that the opponents set up on themselves, and you can get some Vincent von Morlham value. Which could be good. Like, it's a 3-4. Situational, though. So it's definitely playable, but from what I can tell, he's situational. Many times against me, he just did nothing. Philip von Morlham, damage unit by 1 cooldown, when the target has a status, damage it by 2 instead. So again, with this you would want like bleeds, but that doesn't stay up for long. You want maybe locks. You probably don't want poison, because the poison ones just die. I mean, he's an okay guy, but like, he's playable. He gets a lot of damage done, but I feel like the setup for him is like locks and bleeds are just okay, so that makes him okay, and yeah, that's it. He's actually excellent at killing the Scarabs, so they actually are a very good combo. So if you, it's good against Syndicates, at least against the Scarabs, and he's just good against some other status effects, it's not too bad to set him up. It's not too bad. They're just a okay combo, actually. And now we got von Morlham's Cupbearer. Assimilate, deploy, and poison a unit, and purify a unit. So purify can get rid of a taunt, or just other poisons, and you can poison people. So this is pretty damn good. I do like the versatility of it. You don't even need to do the assimilate part. So, I mean, it's a pretty good card. I don't know if, like, well, in this case, it's not, like, must-haves here. They're just, like, playable. They're good. Like, this is a 3-4. This is almost, like, it's not exactly a 4, because you wouldn't put it into, like, you can make the argument this is a core card. This is a core card in probably Assimilate, and could be a core card in Poison. So, this could be a 4, pretty much so. But I do feel like this is probably closer to a 3, and he's more closer to a 3 because they tend to be a little bit more situational. Thirsty Dame, veteran enemy unit, receives a status, boosts up by 1. I don't feel like the Thirsty Dame is as good as, for example, like all the pikemen, or we got like, even the crossbowman, or we have even the guys here, Nausicaa Sergeant, and that's a long list. It's a long list that are better than you. Although you can have double status in one turn, and you can get some value generation going, so it's not terrible. And she does have the advantage of being an aristocrat, so that triggers the masquerade ball that you shouldn't play. You can play for fun, I'm saying, but like, expect some artifact hunters by some boring people. So, yeah, I mean, she's okay, but others are a little bit easier to trigger. So, I mean, she's free. She can get better in the future. Hunting pack, if the enemy unit has status, summon all copies of this unit from your deck to this row. Bit of synergy with the collar. I didn't even realize that. And yeah, I mean, it's a deck thinner. It's an okay deck thinner. It's playable. It's not a core card. It should be doable in most archetypes. One Mortalhelm Servant, give an allied unit vitality with duration equal to the number of enemy units with status. The problem is, like, okay, you might apply a lot of locks. This is okay in the long round, but when you're doing poison statuses, you usually want to kill the guys, not just like, hey, you're poisoned, I guess I won't kill you until the very end. That's usually not how you do it. So, and bleeds just disappear eventually, and locks kind of stay on, but locks are probably the priciest and the most premium. I've just showed this guy, but he's the one who's comes last. Anyway, and then you actually trigger vitality. If it was boost, I would be more on board. But she's playable. Like, you can have like 3-4 status on the enemy, then you trigger trigger vitality. But keep in mind, it needs to be like, then you spend 4 turns putting on the status, then you play this. And you gonna have like other value generators to consider. So I think realistically, this is like a plus 2 to 3 points in a long round. So very situational. I say this is playable. It should be easy to get like 2 points from Van Borlem Servant. The reason why I'm tempted to give him like a free minus is because Nilfgaard tends to be a very reactive faction and tends to one cards that can be played on the board unconditionally. So a little bit like a Thirsty Dame, kind of, it can be an opener. That's what I'm saying. So opener, and she's certainly not that. One Mortalhelm Hunter. So we got the One Mortalhelm Hunter here. Oh my god, this video is getting long. I thought like, oh yeah, let's just crack this thing in like 10 minutes. But damn, a lot to do here. So give an enemy minion bleeding for 2 turns, range lock a unit. Okay, I mean, this is extremely good. Like, it just does 2 things at the same time. This is just better than any locker before. But is lock that good? Because usually, like, it's poison spam, because that also kills the unit. So why lock a unit if you can just effectively double lock it and it dies? So so poison is definitely more popular and a stronger option currently. But lock is decent. Like, when it comes to this guy, like, playing him for 5, that's not really worth writing home about. But he does have a lock, and he kind of pays 3 stats for that. Is it worth paying 3 stats for a lock? No, it's not really. 2 stats would be more in line. I think 4-for-4 with a lock, that would be a little bit better. I think he's playable, despite the fact that he just looks ridiculous. He's not that ridiculous, because you want provision plus 2 value, and he gives up 3 stats for a lock. And he does have bleeding too, but that's not worth it either. So he's just playable. So in all realms, we got the boost and allied unit and give it shield. I mean, situational, like, obviously it kind of depends on what you're dealing with here. Like, if your shield is wasted, like, tactical advantage could be just as protecting, because it gives you 5 points, and shield does not help you. does not help you win the round. It's just like effectively just by points alone. So I mean, with tactical advantage also allows you to go for like a push. But if you have the shield, then you're really committing. You can just go for a tempo pass with tactical advantage, but with shield, you just want to protect an engine, which is decent. We got siege. Same thing. It's always worth it, except it gets destroyed and it's not worth it. So the next one, so this is a 2, and this is like a, I don't know if I would call it a 4. This is like a 3-4. It's not exactly like a must have. We got the War Elf in here. Damage adjacent units by 4, then boost up by 4 for each unit damage. So this is like a 16. But you need to have a situation where you hit shielded units or armored units. And that could be a pro in itself, as we'll see. But, I mean, this is okay. I don't know. I'm not exactly sure. This is a 3-4 here. 3-4, because he's not auto must have, but I think you can probably get a lot of value from him. It's a core, could be a core if you can at all set him up. But if you can't set him up, then he's gonna be like a 12. Like, I just say you have like one condition to fulfill. Then it's a 12 for 12. I mean, that's not that good. So, in my mind, I think, well, actually, that's how the game works, kinda. You need to trigger the condition twice, and you have to make sure that you're not actually hitting your own units. Like, they are not taking damage. They are just losing armor or losing shield. So, something along those lines. I mean, it's like 3-4. Kinda depends. Immortals, shield. Whenever this unit loses shield, boosted by 2. At the end of your turn, gain shield. This is pretty sick. You can actually, well, if you had the option to hit your own units, you can actually hit this for points. So this is pretty good. Also, this works really well with War Elf. The only problem with the Immortals is that it's a gold. I would like to have 2 of these, but just having one doesn't really allow you to build a deck around it. But I think still a really, really strong unit. It has some very cool interactions. And of course, we got King Ragnar here. Who... No. It's Nor Realms. Where's King Ragnar? I think he's not that expensive. I can just type him in. King. I think he's King. Yeah, we got King Ragnar here. Remove shields from all units, then boost self by 3 for every shield removed. This is a guy that's a little bit pushed in this expansion. And Immortal definitely makes him better. So he's pretty good. Like, Immortal is pretty good. We got War Chariot here. Give an enemy unit bleeding for 4 turns. Yeah. Or move an enemy unit to the other row. Combine both deploy abilities if you have crew. Do you really care too much about the movement? I mean, he's like a 9-7, which is okay. He's also a machine and siege engine, so if you care about that tag, that could be interesting. But crew, which is you need to have soldiers here, and then you deploy both abilities. I just don't really know. Like, the thing is, moving an enemy is usually pretty situational. That's a bit of a meta call, but it can shut down abilities. So, I mean, that could be really nice. So, I think the War Chariot is a playable card, but it's really not something that, oh yeah, I'm gonna have it in all the decks. It's also not an order card, so it doesn't work with that archetype. Immortal Cavalry, a 6/6 that has a shield on it. So obviously you might wanna consider this with King Ragnar. Gives you a lot of units, so it could be good with some big units like Drog, for example. And it's good with War Elephant, for example. So, I mean, fulfilling the War Elephant's condition is not that hard, but at the same time, getting a 6/6 is not particularly impressive. You would at least want a 7/6, but ideally an 8/6. So he's just okay, but it does enable the War Elephant. It does work with King Ragnar, but I think it's a little passive. Oh, let's just look at the premium. Damage an enemy unit by 5. Then Deathblow, purify adjacent units. Yeah. I mean, purify could be good. And, but yeah, I mean, making this work could be tricky. You would need more damage. I think this is just playable. It's fine. Also, this looks dumb as hell. These guys getting poured. These, oil is getting poured on them, and they just like, yeah, we just hold it up. That's not how it works, okay? Whatever, boiling oil. It's just okay. I don't think it's like an auto-include. It's a 5/5, but it has very respectable damage. And this is what we see in other factions as well, that 5 damage is getting more common. So getting your value cards to 6 points, or yeah, like some of them are at 4 points. Very few of them are at 3 points, but value generators tend to be at like 4 points, and this can just like deny them. But then you pay 5 to do that, and you also purify. So this is decent. This is a good card. I think it's a playable card, but it's not like, oh my god, I'm just gonna have boiling oil in every single of my decks. We got the Carabellista, damage an enemy unit by 2, and crew gain armor. It's like a 7-for-5. This is the easiest 7-for-5 in your life, and that has order. And if you have crew, you actually become a little bit tougher to kill. So machine and siege engine tag right there, then the order tag. So I mean, it's okay. Like, this is just like, if you just want a 7-for-5, I mean there you have your guy. I mean, this is like playable. Maybe even like core card. I wouldn't say it's like a core card necessarily. It's not really something that makes the deck, but he's just like, he's okay. Like, you just put this in and really good. Although no realms do have a lot of cards that compete with each other. We got the last guy here, siege ladder. Move an allied unit to the other row and boost it by 2. So I did see this one getting used with I'm just gonna put it out there real quick with a battering ram, and it doesn't work with the battering ram. Move a battering ram to the melee row, then damage the highest enemy by 3. This is an order, so you one time use, so you can't really use it all the time from what I've seen. Other than that, this is like 6-for-4, and you just move your stuff around. So I'm not super impressed, and it's a bit situational. I don't think it's like a trash card, but it's like a playable card. I don't really know why you would wanna... I'm a little bit tempted to give it a 2. Like, if you could rearm the siege ram, then this would be like a 4 to a 5, but because it can do that apparently, then it's like a 6-for-4. It's a situational 6-for-4, which is just not that great. So I'm a little bit like, it's a 2-pointer, I think. Like, this is like a bad card. So unless there's some really good move interaction to be had, so it could be like a 2 to 3 range, depends on the scenario, but it's definitely not an auto include by any means. In elves, we have Anshe Saber, spawn and play Squirtle Neophyte. Funnily enough, neutrals tend to have, like, in this case, have one of the most ridiculous cards, and I don't want to give out the five point too easily. Anshe Saber, spawn and play Skirta Neophyte. This helps get out, I think it's 9th. Where is she? I'm trying to look for her. Aliran. So this actually is, I'm not sure if I would say this is a Anshe Saber is a must have, but it can be a core card, at least in the elves. And this could enable mixed strategies to also get out Aliran. So I mean, this is pretty good. You do have one less point, but you get out Aliran more consistently. So I mean, it's okay. It's an okay card. I'm not okay core card, I don't know, but this definitely helps the elves to push for round one. So it's a good card, but you can definitely live without it. I mean, getting just 5 points, and even if it's just a longer round. So that's why I'm a little bit conflicted here, because even if you're playing elves, you can just say like, you know, I'm gonna push for round one, and you can just play the tactical advantage anyway, and they get 5 points for that. So if you can get out Aliran anyway, which I don't think that's that hard to do, if you just play like pure elves and you don't care about just having a ton of elves on the board, you don't plan on boosting them up, like at least round one, then do you need this? Maybe not. And if you use a mixed elf strategy and you want to use Aliran round one, then it's maybe more of a reason to use it. But it's like an okay card. I think it's like, you can make the argument that this is maybe overrated at this point, although you do see that quite a lot. It could be like a playable card just simply, but It could be like a core card, you know, it just gets out Aliran. It gives you that bit of an extra tempo, and even mixed strategies can play Aliran. Fain Death, same thing. They are always worth it. This one actually is a little cheaper, but yeah, at the start you just get an Elven the Die, which is just worse. So if it gets removed, it's just garbage. So this is a bad card, unfortunately. Renoso, I saw this in action, and it can be okay, but I think it's just a lot of fuss to do it, and you need to use Fain Death to make that a thing. So unfortunately, because of that, this is just a bad card. Maybe even call it a hopeless card, but no, it's not. It is just a bad card. It's not a hopeless card, but you need Fain Death for that, and that's the big one. Because if you run against elves, they have Fain Death, and you artifact remove Fain Death, and they're gonna play a Vernossel on like two Deadeye Commandos, Elven Deadeyes, or unless they also have like traps that they try to. I mean, they just try too hard to make Vernossel good, and at the end he's gonna be like, wow, I got like, I don't know, like 17 points for Vernossel, so good. But you kind of ignore the fact that, oh yeah, but I also gave up like 15 points while I cannot try to set up Vernossel, so not that good. So not that great. Vernossel is pretty bad. If you could just like get Deadeyes out like very easily, then yeah, Vernossel would be better. But like this is just purely based on how convenient it is to just get Deadeyes. Etrial combines with Murlega. Yeah, I mean these are just sevens for seven, which is pretty good. And if you play both of them, then Etrial gains plus 4 damage and Murlega gains bonus 6 damage, but probably Etrial is more consistent. And keep in mind, because you want provision plus 2 value usually, and these only kind of give it to you if you combine them. And of course, if you play Murlega, Murlega dies, that happens, then you play Etrial, you only get a 7. So I think these are not that good. At best, like, they just tend to give you competitive value. Also, they give you removal, so that's nice, because removal tends to be more worth it. So, I mean, if you can do that combo, they are like slightly better than average what you want from that provision range. So, I think they are playable, but they are definitely not great. So far, this might be an okay card, but like you don't really need this in like an elf committed deck. We have Nature's Rebuke, damage done by 5, boost the random ally tree and by 2, so it's like a 4-7, 4-5. Considering that, you know, in many other factions, you can just like, you know, just drop a 7, like, this is like a good example. Like, of course, this is not about just like damage, like, damage unit by 2, like 5, I mean, okay, you have that. Would you really want Nature's Rebuke and have a Treant on board? Treant is, I don't know, I'm not the one to underestimate 5 damage in this game, but I think this is just a playable card, kinda. So I think I'm just gonna call it playable. It's not a great card, especially because it boosts Treants. I mean, you gotta have the, well, there are Treants in the Squirtle set for sure, but there are not that many, like only 3 of them. Because of that, I'm kind of tempted to call this card bad. These are the ones. You play Great Oak last. This one, if you play it early, then it just gets removed. And this guy, you just don't play, basically. Unless in a Harmony deck, in which you probably don't play Nature's Rebuke. So, there you have it. So, it's closer to 2. But, like, others, maybe like spell-based decks, gonna be like, oh yeah, this is 5 damage. And they're just gonna ignore the Dapple effect completely. So it's 2-3, possibly better in the future, a little bit, but not by much. At the end of your turn, boost up by 1 if you control only elf units, ignore the condition if you control Vernossel. So, this is a value generator that starts at a 4 technically, and becomes a 7 in 4 turns. Which is just on curve, break even, becomes like, it gives you a 7 for 5 in 4 turns. So, this is a very fair card. when it comes to value generation, but it has a condition. Boost self by 1 if you control all the elf units? That's a crazy condition. That's not like, oh yeah, I wanna do that anyway. If you play an elf deck, this is just like, yeah, let's just have a value generator. And this is okay because it boosts itself. So this is a fine card, but the condition for it is pretty harsh. If this was just like at the end of your turn, boost self by 1, just that, nothing else. This would be like, okay, it's still fine, I guess. It's still not great. And it's not like a ridiculous unit for elves. If you want that, if you want a ridiculous unit for elves, then just make this comparison. Where is it? It's a 5, I believe. Oh yeah, here is it. Elven Swordmaster, it's a little delayed, but it deals damage. It's melee only, so it can get shut down by my row. But like, this is like a elf-based value generator as well. But like, it's a 5, then in 4 turns, becomes an 8. But and it deals damage, it's melee-based, so it's fine. And this one is just 1 turn slower. And Elven Swordmaster is not like elf only. If you just like put in like some not elf, then the Elven Swordmaster is still gonna be fine. Usually it doesn't get moved around. So this would be a 4. And this is how 3 looks like. So this is just average. It's playable in only elf deck. And it's good to see that the older cards are still keeping up. They're doing just fine. Back to the rest. Brigid Saboteur. It's a little bit more expensive version of the dwarf that does the same thing. Dwarven Agitator. But unlike the dwarf, boosting the dwarf is a little bit better. So this is just worse. Kind of like sets up the elf strategy, but I think this is bad. Maybe playable. Playable because you save points for later. I think it's playable, but I'm really bordering on bad here. And we got Trained Hawk. So there's the selection for elves is a Squirtle is not super impressive. I kind of call them elves because a lot of them are relying on elves. And we got Trained Hawk here, which is a Harmony card. Deals 2 damage or move an enemy to their other row, which can be a nice shutdown effect. Some units are based on specific rows. I do consider the Trained Hawk basically a better tiger. We have the tiger over here. I think that's a 5. Yeah. We have the panther here, which is like a 3 plus 2 damage, and conditionally it's like a range bleeding. But it doesn't have harmony. This one has harmony and has movement instead. I think you would rather use movement than a bleed, although bleed seems pretty good. Many times how it works out in harmony decks, in which decks a panther actually makes the cut, is that you want to play panther late because you just set up all the harmony and you play panther late and you can't play the bleed because you're playing panther late. But with Trained Hawk, you actually have more of a chance to play this early, and if you need a movement, this is really great instead of just relying on the stupid elf movers. And where are they? I think they're here. I think they got changed. They get changed from time to time. Yeah, here they are. So obviously it's not as good as the Vrihid Dragoon, but this has harmony, so I mean it might be better than the Vrihid Dragoon. So maybe just the Vrihid Dragoon plus and Panther plus. It just kind of feels that way. So Trained Hawk is okay. I mean, it's just a better version of it. I think it's playable. I think it's closer to core card. I think it's a core card in harmony. So core card in harmony, but other than that, so Trained Hawk might be the best card here. So these kind of go together, which makes them garbage. This is okay just to get out Aluran, but that's it, just to like cheese out some tempo. These are playable. Nature's Rebuke I would pass on. Vernoso Command is not that impressive, so Squirtle does look to be pretty bad here. When it comes to Skellige, maybe I should just go from the core, the basic ones to the more interesting ones, because that would maybe give us a better... No, I don't care. Let's just go from the best ones. Draw a card and discard a card. I don't think this is worth giving up 5 points. Although, because look at this. Draw a card and discard a card. Wow, that's not bad, right? Not bad, right? Oh, that looks cool, actually. But actually, it's gonna be at 5. The guy I want to look for. Yeah. No, that's not the one. God damn it. Oh yeah, this is the guy. Discard a card and draw a card. Also 4-point body. How interesting is that? Huh. Like, of course, the other one, the hero power, I mean the tactical advantage replacement is the other way around, draw and discard, which might be a little better. I think that's a little better, but it's not like a deal breaker. And like, this gets a 4 body on top of that. I don't know. I don't think the effect is just worth that much. But you need to run a very specific deck to see it. So this just seems bad to me. And it's definitely not something you would use in many decks. Getting that, it's again another trash. But it's always worth it. It's always worth it because look at this. You get the druid and you're gonna get 2 alchemists. So it's like 6 plus you get a 6 plus you get a 6. So it's like, whoa, 18 points. How good is that? But if you just shut down the card after the first option, then you're not going to play the 2 alchemies. The druid is not going to get boosted. It's going to stay at a 4 unless you get some other boost for it. And you're losing like at least like 10 points of value. So again, it's a bad card with how artifact removal stands right now. We got Crew Mother here. Yeah, I mean, maybe you play an Alchemy card, summon Crow Mother from your graveyard to a random row. So you get 7 plus a bunch of beasts, and Crow Mother comes back, which is a human druid if you play Alchemy cards. So Crow Mother is okay, just a way to have some value for later. And this is obviously just for the beast archetype that we'll later see. Axel Free Eyes, spawn a crow in this row, boost self by 1 for each ally beast. So you just want to spam a bunch of crows. I have to say I'm not a huge fan of although the arts look amazing, I'm not a huge fan overall of the type of archetype the Skellig is going for. This is like the spam crows and boost them up. This is all a little bit of carryover value, but Axel Free Eyes is all about just spamming beasts. Jagged Scorpion, the concoction, I should probably raid these cards. So Crow Mother, I think, is just playable. It's not particularly impressive. Axel Free Eyes, again, playable in the Crow deck. It's not particularly impressive. You need to have a lot of beasts. Which is like, the thing is, by himself, he looks okay. He's like a 7 for 7, which is not great. But like, boost self by 1 for each ally beast. But you will see that most of these beasts are very fair. They're not like super broken. If he could just get out Love Crow for cheaply, then he would be better, but we can't do that. A Jagged Scorpion, the concoction, damage unit by 1-6 times. It's very similar to many cards that Skellige has already, and this just helps the ping many times archetype. I think there's a core card in that, so I'm gonna give this a 4, because he just always used this in that archetype. So this seems like a good card. This is just like, hey, archetype, you know, Just a little bit of love for you. It's like, okay. And most of it is just a new archetype. So we got Crow's Eye, Rhizome, spawn 2 crows in an eye row. If you control a droid, spawn 3 instead, which is exactly what you want. But then you just get like 6 crows. So it's a 6 for 5. Keep in mind, 7 for 5 is super easy to do. And better cards actually try to go for more than that. So, I mean, like, this is a conditional 6 for 5. So, do you really want to base it on, and then do you, like, you play Axel Free as like, oh yeah, look at all the crows! yeah, that's the premium version of it. We got Crow Clan Druid, which is a slightly conditional 8 for 5, which is a lot more like it. Getting a bunch of beasts out, I mean, not that hard to do. Like, we get a bunch of crows out, that's only 3 crows. And then you can just play Crow Clan Druid, so 8 for 5, which makes it a lot easier to accept, but at the same time, you play a 6 for 5, then you play an 8 for 5, they only average out to a 7 for 5, and keep in mind, that's just point slamming. So, value generators are gonna reach the same thing in 4 turns. So, I mean, if you just keep doing this, it's not that good. Like, if the round is gonna be longer, you're just gonna lose with point slamming, unless you also have ways to shut down point generators, which is something that many decks did in the past. They just like point slammed plus removed. But I feel like it's harder to do these days. And I'm gonna, although by itself this card is good, but the conditions for it makes it a little bit trickier to use. So I think it's just a playable card. It's not particularly impressive. We got Crow Clown Preacher. Whether you play an alchemy card, boosts up by one. Whether you play a special card, boosts up by one instead. That doesn't really matter because you want to have alchemy cards. If you're running the Crow Clown Preacher, which is like a 4. And this is not a great card because of like a 4-5. And it seems like a value generator. And if you play 3 alchemy cards after you play the Crow Clown Preacher, and it's still just a value generator that reaches 7 for 5 in 4 turns. So it's not worth it. And it's you gotta play alchemy cards? No. This is a bad card. The only reason why this is actually a consideration because it's a druid. And you need to have some druids to set up the crow's eye rhizomes. So no, this is a bad card. Crown Messenger, summon all copies of this unit from your graveyard to this row. If you hold an alchemy card, also summon all copies from your deck. It's mostly just a deck thinner. It's really nothing to really write home about. So, it's possible to resurrect it. I mean, if you really want a 6 for 5, I mean, obviously you get some beasts for that, but it's not great. So, I think it's playable. So, overall, I think the best card, unless you're really crazy about the beast set, which I think sucks. I don't think it just keeps up. And of course, you can say like, oh yeah, I'm gonna play Geti Knight, which supports the beast archetype. But yeah, you play this, you lose. And Crow Mother, I think it's the best piece of the beast archetype. Then you get 7 for 10, which is not great, but you have this extra 3 points for later. And this can come up in round 2, this can come up in round 3. So, I mean, this Crew Mother, if you play it early, she can give you overall 13 points over the match, but actually it's more than that. Because summon Crew Mother from your graveyard to an allied row whenever you play an alchemy card. So you can play Crew Mother in a round, kill her, she dies, and you play an alchemy card and you got her back. So you can use up her points freely. You can just, smash her to bits. Then you play another alchemy card and you got her back. So, I mean, for that alone, I think Crow Mother is a good card. Maybe even a 4, but again, situational. So like, this is like a playable plus. So this is like a 3 plus over there instead. But it's not exactly a core card by any means. You might use it more. I'm going from 1 to 5, so it doesn't give me. If I wasn't going from 1 to 5, she would be like a 7 instead of a 6. And last but not least, we got Syndicate here, and we got Tiger's Eye. Gain 4 coins. I mean, coins are generally better than just boosts. You can use it for damage. You can. Well, maybe the most obvious example, if you can somehow manage to use it with like the Sea Jackal, you can just use these points to gain 6 points instead of like 5. But wouldn't you really have the consistency of the 5 points instead? I'm thinking yes. I would personally prefer that. Tiger Eyes definitely remains a competitive option, but it's not a core card. You don't really need to get it. So it's like a playable plus. It's like it's a 7. 7 out of 10. We got Collusion here. It's actually not that. We got Passive Flora. Another really great card if you could get some value. But you can't. You can't. Passive Flora Peaches. Like, that's a 5 cost card. So maybe this is the card that makes it the least punishing if you get shut down, because you get a 5 cost Passive Flora Peach. And if you get artifact removed, then you only lose 7 points of value. But that 7 points of value is actually pretty good, because this is a 5 cost card, this is a 4 cost card, so that's like 9 points coming up. And playing units with fees, not that tricky. You don't even have to play spenders, core spenders. You can play some units that, you know, that have just some spawn spending ability that you will not use at all. So Passive Flora, I might even tempted to give this a free because it's better, but it's, I still can't justify it because if you get Artifact counter on you, then you just lose 7 points. And your opponent does play a little bit for the Artifact counter, but you're still getting punished brutally. So no, I can't really justify it. So it's gonna be still a 2. I just can't give these cards better points here. Look at Collusion here. It seems really good on paper. Increase all of the effects by 1. Boost an allied unit with the lowest power by 4. Damage an enemy unit with the highest power by 4. Spawn 2 Fire Sworn Zealots in random allied row. Gain 4 coins. This kind of adds up to like a 24-ish, I think. No, this is like 15 overall. I'm just adding to a point. Like, no, it's 21. 21 points. 21 points for 12 provisions, but blind eyes are cool, die cloaks are cool, cut ups and crown splitters. So you can have those guys. Fire sworn suck. So not that easy. And if you don't use the fire sworns, then you're already like, okay, I'm getting 15 points, kind of, but 15 ish. I'm like, oh, okay, like, but then you still gotta have all of these. And you gotta spend at least 5 turns playing all these guys, and they have to not die, and you're not even, and we're not even talking about like value generation considerations here necessarily, because you're just caught up in like trying to fulfill some conditions here. It's not terribly bad, but like, let's just say you spend 3 turns putting up value generators, then you like spend 3 more turns trying to fulfill the condition. Like, this is something that you can maybe use in a long round, but at the same time, it's like, is it really worth the fuss? And if one guy dies, it's like, oh, I guess I'm getting only like 10 points worth of value, or 12 points worth of value, or whatever. Like, I don't know. It's a bit of a risk, and I think it's really worth it. I would just rather focus on putting in some good cards. I think it's a playable card, could be a core card in the future. But for now, it's just an okay card, even though it looks ridiculous on paper, unless you can fulfill the conditions. And it's not going to be ridiculous either, because in a long round, because this is just a long round and give you fixed points. And you can say like, oh, this is a finisher. But not necessarily. And damage an enemy unit with the highest power, then enemy has a shield, might have an armor on it. So it's not like safe points in the first place, because boost allies with the lowest power, you might have this damage wasted. So that's fine. In rare cases, you might not even have free slots for free fire sworn zealots, but that's probably less of a concern. You can definitely make this work, but I feel like it's probably not going to be worth it. At least I tried to, and it just didn't worth it. We got here Ludovicious, Brown and Brown. After 3 turns, gain 6 coins. So this is on 11 for 7. I'm pretty close to giving him a 5, but because he can be shut down, worst case scenario, he's a 7 for 7. Although if you use him with King of Beggars, he's an 8 for 7, guaranteed. And because of his tributes, I'm super tempted to give him a really high points. And because you pay for coins, then gain a lot of coins, that means he's really good with Binsey. Not like, you know, gain 2 coins, you know. After 3 turns, gain 6 coins, or, you know, just gain 2 coins. No. You gain 6 coins. That's huge. So anything that gets triggered, like Binsey gets triggered by coins, then that's 6 points for Binsey. So I'm really tempted to give him a 5. Like, even if he gets shut down, it's not the worst. He's fairly tanky, and like getting 11 points and 6 coins for 7. I think this is as close to a must have as you can get. And I'm kind of tempted to give it to him because he's just ridiculously good. Not what once he got shut down when I was playing him. It might happen in the future, so it might be just a core card, but like, it's a ridiculously good card. If I was giving out points, then he would be the 9. and just like a 1 to 10 scale. Sol, the Navarrete, at the end of the turn, boosts up by 1, Hort 6 and 9 goes up by 1. He looks bad, but if you go up to Hort 6, then you can play him as a 6. At 6, he doesn't get killed by many things, and staying at Hort 6 is not that hard. So you can think of him as like a beast from the monsters that just like keeps generating points and can get to this level too. 3 points a turn. I did this, and it won me the game. Only sucks against poison guys, but the scarabs kind of help with that, which I do recommend. But I think Saladin of Rat is deceptively strong. Hoarding is not that hard. So, I think he's a core card. He's definitely not Ludovicious level, but Saladin of Rat is ridiculously strong. So, I do like what Syndicate got. I know this could be like a joy kill way of looking at things, but like, you know, I like these cards. I like Passiflora, but I do like Collusion. They are fun cards, but like, their effect, they're not gonna be super effective. Passiflora is as close as you can get to like maybe a playable version of these scenarios. Bloody good friends. Insanity, fee, give an enemy unit bleeding for one turn. If it's boosted, damage it by one instead. It doesn't matter too much if boosted, damage it by one instead. So we have a way to spend all our gold, but he doesn't really have a way to kill people. He just bleeds them. I don't really consider bleed a kill. That's just, I would rather take boost over bleed. Because then you can actually protect your guys instantly with that. And might even take vitality over bleed, because that triggers at the end of your turn. Bleed triggers at the end of your opponent's turn. So that's not great either. If bleed at least triggered at the start of your opponent's turn. But no. So, bleed is just not great. Although Insanity just gives him, you can use up his health and you can heal him up, so that's a consideration to have. But I don't know if that is good enough. It wasn't good enough for a long time now. Blind Eye. Yeah, you can. Even if he just tribute 2, you pay 2 gold to heal and deploy. So you pay 2 to heal by 4. But I don't think there are just enough cards out there to really justify using Blind Eye. You can like probably get away with using one Blind Eye. But also at the same time, and probably it's not worth it just for the bloody good friends. It's not a great card. It's like a 5 for 5. And it's a spender that doesn't have a way to spend instantly or like get instant value. If you just try to spend with him at the last round, it just does nothing. You can just hit boosted enemies, so that could be like an instant spend, but it's conditional and it just doesn't kill stuff. I just feel like this doesn't do anything. The only way I could see him doing stuff is like he just like bleeding a bunch of very weak units that are actually going to die. Bleed can also have a bit of an advantage where you are trying to get rid of shields, so maybe playable. I think it's playable, but not great. Passiflora Peaches, it's very similar. At the end of turn, boost up by 1. It's a little bit better value generator. It's situational, but it's a 5 for 5 on play, and in 3 turns it becomes a 7 for 5. It's competing with other 5-pointers like Sly Seductress, which is a 4 for 5, but if your opponent plays a unit, then it goes up on their turn, and at the start of your next turn, she's already a 5. So, Sly Seductress is very similar, only has a different condition. Sly Seductress can get more value because your opponent is playing a unit. Your opponent possibly can play 2 units at the same turn, so you get 2 points. But your opponent might not play units. So I feel like Passiflora Peach is a more consistent, although you gotta have some gold. So while you can play Sly Seductress early, which actually is a big advantage, because that's exactly what you want from value generators. The only way to make Passiflora Peaches comparable is that you also need to have some gold. But how you have to have some gold? Like, if you have to spend one turn to get the gold, so you might just play like tax collector twice, and maybe like hero power, and you know. But the point is, you want to play the value generators early, and you want to enable the passive lore features. If you spend 3 rounds just not playing value generators to enable the passive lore features, or even like 2 rounds, that makes passive lore features 2 points worse than the Sly Seductress. So the passive lore features are only comparable. I think if you have the condition for them, passive lore features are better than the Sly Seductress. But if you have to spend too much time getting to Horde 4, then that's not going to be worth it. So this is a little bit, you probably want to play at least a medium coin deck, definitely not a low coin deck. So you need to get some coins, but passive lore features are pretty good, so I like them. Good choice. I think it's playable. It's not like ridiculous. I think the tax collector, Sly Seductress, and passive lore features are all decent. My favorite would be the tax collector. You gain gold, but actually tax collector looks deceptively good, and also passive lore features look deceptively good. What you have to keep in mind is that despite the fact that these units look strong, they are not that strong, because for example, you got the elves that I called a piece of shit. Well, not really a piece of shit. They are just like, okay, they are decent. So we got these elves here, Vernosos Commando. So they seem one turn slower, but there's a catch. When it comes to syndicate cards, the last turn doesn't quite count. So you have the Merchants of Adir. We can just go to not just Merchants of Adir. We have Syndicate Fives, and not just new expansion. So we got the tax collector. Last round you get the gold. It doesn't give you anything. Last round you're probably not gonna hover on 4 gold to get 1 boost. You're probably gonna spend all your gold. So last round passive lore peach will not get a gold. But you might just pass last round, and you have the Sly Seductress, and your opponent plays a unit. And yeah, I mean, you get a point for that. So, I mean, this is a bit of a tough call, but I think Tax Collector and Sly Seductress, I would give them a slight bonus, slight edge, because even though Sly Seductress doesn't always get the points, she does if you bond her, and Tax Collector... Although, I think coins are a little bit better than boost. And passive lore peach, again, last round, you're not gonna get the hoard value. Same with tax collector, but you get coin with that. And you know, they are all pretty well balanced. I think passive lore peach is playable, and decent round, she's just gonna get decent value. And also, she boosts herself. And yeah, that makes her a little bit harder to kill. And we got here payroll specialist, intimidate profit 2, attribute 2, move a unit to the row. That's pretty situational, and you need to play a bunch of crime cards. I don't think the crime cards are particularly impressive right now, and it's just a 5/5 with a very situational tribute ability. Well, I guess like, but it's also a tribute ability, not even a fee. You just tribute on deploy. If it was a fee, I would be more impressed. But even then, I would probably just call it garbage. It just seems bad. It just entirely depends on the viability of the crime cards. But again, this is like a 5/5 where the value generator effect is based on you actually just playing crime cards. So this is as close to garbage as you can get. So I think it's like a 2. And we got the street urchins here, which is a 5/4. A fee 1, boost up by 1. So this is actually an excellent complement to the Sea Jackal. It's very similar. The Sea Jackal gets played for a 4/4, and it's also a spender and can get a little bit of extra. The Street Urchin, in my opinion, an excellent complement to the Sea Jackal. If I can find it right now. Can I see? Yeah, they're here. You get a 5/4, a little bit more upfront, but you don't have that oomph. And also, you get profit free, so that can get can trigger some effects and profit. Like gold tends to be a little bit better than just boost. Of course, you can use this profit free. Like for example, if you just use the gold on the siege echo, then you're getting a little bit more value. So I think the street urchin is an excellent spender. Also have a way to, you know, sometimes it's just really tricky to use up all your gold. You're just gonna have one left over and like, oh yeah, I guess again, you know, use it up with the street urchin. So street urchin is like a core card. I consider the street urchin and the siege echo the most consistent spenders currently. And that's about it, I think. So we ran through everything. The best cards are a little bit like neutral. I think the biggest winner of this expansion, and I like this quite a lot, is Matahure. Ridiculous card. And morale. So these are the best cards. Matahure, morale, monsters. I don't know. If there's a best card here, then it's gonna be Penitent and Plague Maiden. In this, the best card is obviously Warren Morlham's Cupbearer. This is decent too, the color, but I think the Cupbearer is the best choice, especially for like the poison deck. You can just like remove taunts with Purify. That's kind of nice. These are a decent combo, but I think they may need a little bit. They didn't impress me yet. No realms. I really like the Immortal. Immortals are pretty damn good. And nothing else really stands out like, oh yeah, that's really good. So I don't think the Immortals alone gonna be super impressive. Nothing that really enables archetypes here. This is just okay stuff. Like, War Elephant could be an okay finisher, but you need to set it up so you can just like slam it into any deck. Yeah, Square Tile basically has nothing going on here. Unfortunately, I think the Alvin strategy a little bit flopped. The biggest winner here is the Trained Hawk, which is a little bit better Panther, maybe a little bit better mover guy, mover elf, which makes the elves even worse, but barely. This is like, why even exist? You're just okay. Skellige, I think the best ones are the Gigascorpion, the Concoction, and maybe the Crow Mother. Crow Mother can make it in other decks as well, because you can just kill Crow Mother and she comes back, but then you're playing alchemy cards. But when it comes to alchemy cards, not alchemy cards have to suck. Some alchemy cards are pretty okay, not the new expansion only, but you have like Resurrects, you have Restores. Again, some cards are pretty good. Even this is an alchemy card, so yeah, that's it. You can have some alchemy cards, but probably Crow Mother is not that impressive, but still, like, I would say that Gigascorpion the Collection is the better option here. Partially because it can just like target kill a unit, and if that unit has a shield, like, it doesn't matter. It's a pretty good card. Even if you're not running a Pinger Warrior deck, you just want to kill a unit. Like, this is just so much better than dealing 6 damage. This is like 6 times 1 damage. I'm like, I would take this. Even if I was not... Well, this is just pretty good removal. And the Syndicate, yeah, I mean, Ludovicious and, surprisingly, Sol are pretty damn good. And I think that kind of concludes it. I know this was a pretty long video, and if you watched to this point, just leave something in the chat. I probably should just make shorter videos, because maybe people just wanna care about the TLDR, like, what should I craft about this expansion, but... I personally enjoy watching videos like this and making videos like this, and just like knowing about all the cards. It's good to hear. So anyway, guys, that's it for now, and thanks for watching.